Hey guys, I'm Jackie Brubaker. I'm an author, a motivational and career coach, and host of That Girl, the podcast. Each week, I bring on a leader in their field to talk about how to stop making excuses and how you can start living your lifelong dream. That Girl, the podcast is based on That Girl, the novel, which is on Amazon to download or buy the paperback of. To find books, courses, and products from our episodes, check out the shop page at thatgirlcoaching.com. You can also follow us on Instagram at Jackie Brubaker and at That Girl, the podcast, and our Patreon page. Welcome, Danielle Harold, to That Girl, the podcast. I'm excited to have you on. You are the divorce dad over 40, and you're going to talk about dating over 40, being divorced, all of the stuff that people are trying to navigate into their 40s. This is a whole new ball game. It's very different. It's, you know, it's difficult at times, but it can also be very rewarding. So we're going to talk about that. And we're going to talk about you and how you got here. So I like to let people introduce themselves in brief because I feel like you can always do a better job than I can. So please introduce yourself.
Well, Jackie, thanks for having me on. And, you know, it's funny. I've kind of branded myself as the divorced dad, and my ex-wife actually sent me a text last week, said, "You're the divorced dad." I was like, I guess that's what I'm known as. And I guess it's not bad. But yes, just a little bit of background on me. I was born and raised here in Oklahoma, as you can tell with a little bit of the twang that I've got in my accent.
It's charming.
And I was married pretty much right out of college for 22 years. And dated her through college. So I had a 26-year relationship. We had three kids who are I'm almost an empty nester. Mm-hmm. And we got divorced almost 2.5 years ago. So, you know, I came out of, you know, being married for such a long time and raising kids to had never really honestly dated ever before. I mean,
right.
I literally have never dated. And so just navigating being single for the first time, you know, since high school.
And very different.
Yeah. I mean, I've learned a lot. I feel like I've got a lot of wisdom and I'm happy to share it.
Awesome. Okay. So that's a long time to be with one person. That is a accomplishment in itself. I was just watching this show where these people had been together for 60 or 65 years. And I was like, that is someone's lifetime. How did they do that? Yours is also a lifetime. So yeah, I mean, dating in high school is a totally different planet. You're on a totally different planet. Your brain's not even finished developing. What was that like? I think let's talk to the people who are going through divorce, who are newly divorced and like in that kind of new stage. Let's talk to men specifically, because I talk to a lot of women and I think
right.
We would all really appreciate a man's perspective. When do you think it is time to start dating after a divorce as a man?
I get that question asked a lot of me because I think that, and I think, you know, I'm not going to use too much generalities when I answer this, but in most cases, if there's a long marriage in which there's an ending, like a divorce, whether it's a toxic breakup or whether it's an amicable breakup, a lot of times what I've seen is that most women kind of take a year off where they're just kind of healing, maybe working on themselves before they dive into the dating pool. When it comes to men, it's like we dive right into the deep end immediately. Mm-hmm. And, you know, when you think about that, and I did the same, I literally, when we were separated, we talked about the fact that it was okay that we both dated during that time because we knew that we were evolving to a divorce.
Right.
And I dove right into it. And I think that the reason why I think guys do it is because I just feel like we just have a need to have a connection. Mm-hmm. And, you know, when you move out and you're single, and you start feeling all those emotions of being lonely. And a lot of times, you know, most married men that are divorced don't have a lot of single guy friends. So you've lost all your friends. And so where do you go to grab connection is through dating. And it's so easy. I just get on an app and 5 minutes later, I'm swiping. And right. So, I don't think that's the right formula. I wish in hindsight that I would have spent a little bit of time to kind of let the dust settle, to go through some of the healing process. I do think, however, dating is a great part of your healing process because it allows you to discover yourself. It allows you to figure out what you like, what you don't. Mm-hmm. But, you know, I don't know. I think it's not specific. It's so specific on every person, but I'd almost say at least 3 to 6 months, you should at least kind of, you know, get settled in your new norm. And then you can start looking to date instead of like right out of the gate.
Right. Right. So, right. Cause I think so many women are like, oh my God, I can't even think about dating. But I will say this, especially in long-term relationships or marriages, sometimes you've been checked out for years and you don't really, it's a different type of grief once it's actually ended. Like maybe you've been emotionally checked out for a long time and like kind of over the relationship, but now it's the grief of like the permabonding that isn't there anymore. The new house, the new routine, the loneliness that does creep up. You're so used to working as a team. Do you think that a lot of men feel that immediately and are just like, I need a partner, like you said, like they're looking for connection? Or is it more, I'm looking for connection temporarily?
I think that a lot of guys generally dive into long-term committed relationships way too soon, and they don't know what they're doing a lot of times. A lot of it is just the need for sex. A lot mm-hmm. of it is the need for the physical and emotional intimacy of a connection. And a lot of men, you know, you feel free and you're like, I want to go see what I'm capable of. And the dating apps make that really easy. Mm-hmm. And you get caught up into, you know, the flirting and being, you know, all the attention. And mm-hmm. so, yeah, I still think that even though I actually have a friend of mine that was emotionally checked out of his marriage, you know, for the better part of 12 to 18 months prior to the actual divorce decree. And I still think that there's some new norms that you have to go through, even though the emotional piece, you may be there, there still is, you know, you're moving into an apartment or a house, you're co-parenting for the first time because you've now physically split, mm-hmm. you're cooking for yourself, you're learning all these new skill sets.
Yeah.
And, you know, I just know in my own personal experience that if I would have waited a little bit, you know, I just went through too many crash and burns mm-hmm. in my early dating. Now, fortunately for me, I got it. I figured out, man, I really love dating. It's fun, but I don't need a relationship. I just mm-hmm. need to casually date mm-hmm. and I need to be transparent and direct with the people that I date, that that's where I am in my life.
Right.
And it took me two relationships to figure that out. And then once I communicated that and assuming that the other party was okay with that, I had a blast. It was a lot of fun.
Let's talk about.
I wish in hindsight I'd known that earlier.
Yeah, let's talk about the crash and burns real quick to maybe help some people avoid those, men and women. You know, like what was that? Like, how did that happen? How did it crash and burn like that? Well, I have an idea, but you know.
Yeah, the first one was I started dating someone that was, you know, 16 years under me in age. Mm-hmm. And so, and a lot of guys do that, you know, and it's, I don't know if it's just like a conquest, you know, I want to be able to see that I can still slay someone or, you know, attract mm-hmm. someone that's younger. Mm-hmm. But you kind of see that a lot. For me, yeah, I got enamored with the fact that there's this, you know, 29-year-old woman that finds me attractive. Mm-hmm. And, but the problem with that is and I got into a committed relationship with her. And, the problem with a relationship that early is that you really don't know I didn't know who the new Daniel looked like.
Right.
I didn't know what my goals were, where I wanted to be in my life in the next chapter. And so you start to get all these questions that pop up through that relationship. Like, for example, she said, you know, I haven't had kids. I want kids.
Yeah.
I want to get married. I want to have kids. How do you feel about that? And, you know, I'm like, well, first of all, I'm still married. You know?
So there's that.
And, Yeah, I was like, I hadn't even thought about that. I don't know. I guess I might be open to it. That's how I answered. And it was a truthful answer at the time. You know, 3 months into it, I was like, I remember specifically waking up in the middle of the night and going, holy crap. I don't want to cuss on your podcast.
Oh, you can. It's okay.
Holy shit. I don't want kids. My youngest daughter is 16. Mm-hmm. And so I think that there's a lot of self-discovery that you need to go through before you are looking for that committed relationship. And I jumped into something real, and you know, it's hurtful. It's hurtful to her because then she's thinking, well, he's given a bunch of false promises when in fact, mm-hmm. I just really didn't know what I wanted. And I think going through dating and getting the reps of it get you to a point where each date that you have a better idea of what you want, what you don't want. And I just didn't do that.
Absolutely. I just kind of ran into that with someone who was about 10 years older than me. And I wasn't sure. I'm like, maybe I do want kids. Maybe I don't. I don't know. I'm like in a kind of an age now where I'm like, well, I could probably still do it, but do I want to? It's kind of up in the air. And as I started to date this person, I was like, oh, I do want to not, I want to have kids. Like I definitely do. And just like you said, like whether it's the woman or the man, you need to date to find out. You know, because going in, I was like, no, it sounds like great. Like no kids. It'll be like, we're retired. This is great. But then I'm like, oh, but I still think I want to do this. And so that happens. What about when you kind of got through the crash and burn and then you were like, okay, I just want to like casually date and have fun. How do you tell that to a woman?
Well, I believe I've mastered the art of that.
Oh, good. Tell us how to do it.
And I did it from a perspective that I'm proud to say that 90% of the women that I casually dated, I still talk to. Matter of fact, I sent Christmas cards to a lot of them. They've become friends. Nice. What I did was, I mean, it's hilarious, but it's true. Yeah. What I realized was that number one is I need to be honest and transparent with my intentions with people that I'm dating. It's not fair for me to go in with someone that's looking for a long-term relationship and I'm not there. I'm like this. Right. Mm-hmm. And so a lot of it was, I traveled a lot. This was pre-COVID. I traveled a lot. And so I dated when I traveled. Mm-hmm. And so I'd go into, let's say I'm going to LA, I'd get on Bumble LA or Hinge LA, match up with people, start the dialogue. And I was very intentional in my bio by saying, you know, where I was in my stage of life, recently divorced. I'm still trying to discover myself, not looking for anything serious. And, you know, a lot of times people miss the actual text of the bio because they're looking at the visual, women included.
Yeah.
And then you have to kind of talk through it again. And so there's a lot of women that I would match with that are like, you know what, that's not where I am. And, you know, I'm really looking for something serious, but I wish you the best. Mm-hmm. Great. But at least I set it up front.
Yes.
And then there's other women that are like, hey, if you're ever in LA, I'd love to go have a drink with you. Mm-hmm. And that's where those opportunities presented themselves, where it's setting up front, you know, what your intentions are, and then allowing them to make that choice and to see if it's aligned. Mm-hmm. And I felt like through that, by just being upfront and honest and transparent, women found it very refreshing because mm-hmm. a lot of guys disguise that on the dating mm-hmm. apps. Mm-hmm. and if they were at that stage where they're willing to do it, they would do it. And I looked at it, Jackie, as an opportunity to make friends.
Yeah.
I was like, I would love to learn more about, you know, I got to know people through the pre-date. And then when I got to the date, we'd already kind of known each other a little bit through texting and so forth. And then it was just like establishing friendships. Mm-hmm. So it was a lot of fun.
That's awesome. Okay. So where are you now? Are you looking for a serious relationship? Are you dating someone? Are you still in casual mode?
Great question. So when COVID occurred, pretty much everybody's dating lives halted to a stop, and mine included. And I kind of, this was back in like March or it was about April or May of last year. You know, my traveling stopped and I'm looking back and I'm saying, okay, what have I accomplished in the last 12 to 18 months? I was like, not a whole lot. I mean, I have a lot of friends mm-hmm. That I've met, but I have no friends here locally. Mm-hmm. And I really made a conscious effort over the next really from that point forward to really focus on cultivating friendships at a local level. And that's what started a lot of the divorce community that I've built from that. But I found like this circle of five or six friends, four women and another guy. And we were like a pack of thieves hanging out and became very close. And we started to have these social events, like cookouts at one of this guy's house once a week. And we kept inviting like our circle of friends. And it ended up being like, it was like a divorce party, honestly. It was like, and then the divorce friends would invite the divorce friends and the divorce friends would invite the divorce friends. All it's of a sudden like we're creating singles. A cookout where, yeah. And there were like 20 or 30 people each time that nobody was going with a premonition that I'm going to go, I'm looking for a day. We were just, it was like potluck, you know, bring a side dish. And I met someone there organically. Oh. Didn't I wasn't looking. I was excited about being single and really enjoying the friendship aspect. And bam, someone was there that I was like, wow, she kind of knocked me off my heels. And we've been dating ever since. And so, and I was, you know, when I got up, you know, I started dating her initially, I was like, I did the same thing. I'm not looking for anything serious. You know, this is where I am in my stage of life. I wanted to be very explicit about my intentions and she was fine with that. But then over the course of our dating, I fell in love. And so we're, you know, 9 months into it. And I got off all the apps and now I'm just focused on the relationship. But the community that I'm building, you know, it's enabling and fostering organic relationships, friendships first.
Yeah.
Potentially romantic. And that's what I love. And I think that's the best model in a lot of cases.
I love hearing that. Dating in the wilds. When you meet someone in the wild, it seems so
nobody
rare.
Nobody does it, Jackie. Nobody does it anymore.
No. And it's so, so special. Honestly, it is so romantic too, to like see someone across the room and be like, who is that? And then start talking to them like a person does. That's exciting. Congratulations for one.
Yeah. No, it's so fun. And to your point, I'm not the type of guy. And I think most people aren't the type when they're in their 40s and 50s to where you're going to go to a bar and sit at the bar and wait for people to come up and talk to you. That just doesn't happen anymore. Mm-hmm. Or very few people do that. And so everybody asks at this age, it's like the dating apps can be overwhelming. And frankly, a lot of people get disenfranchised with them. And so a lot of people are like, where can I just meet like-minded people that are my age? And there's, you know, there are ways to do it. You just have to be creative. And those are so much more magical.
Absolutely. Okay. That's a really good question. How can people better create groups to meet people like this?
Well, I'd say join my community because we're growing nationally. But if you're not, even if you're in your 30s or 20s and you're like, I hate the dating apps.
Yeah.
Expand your friend group and be very intentional with your friends to meet as regularly as you can. We were meeting weekly. We had a Thursday cookout, potluck, bring your own alcohol or drinks. We'll cook the meat. You guys bring all the dishes. Invite your friends. And that's where you're going to meet organic people, because one of your friend's friends is going to invite someone else and you're going to be like, wow, that's a great connection. And you're not going there with the intention of meeting someone from the opposite sex. You're going to hang out with friends and meet new people. And so I think it's take the pressure off, but just be really social.
I love this. This is so, it is very refreshing because I'm not an app person at all. Like I go on for like a week and I'm like, this is terrible and I'm gone. And it's very overwhelming. You know, there's so many people that you're like, nope. And there's so very few that you're like, maybe. So, and I think two people want, well, first of all, I think when people meet in real life, just in passing, whatever it is at a party, you see that person in a much more clear way. Even the way they look can look different because their energy is there. And so it's different than looking at a picture where maybe their energy looks a certain way, but then in real life, they're very different. So first of all, I think that's just magical.
Well, you save so much time, don't you, Jackie? I mean, how many people have you matched with and you're like, wow, this person's good. The banter's good. And then you meet with them and it's like talking to a wall. You
absolutely.
Know? Like, I just wasted a lot of time. So you're right.
Yeah. I mean, I'm certainly doing the phone calls and virtual dates these days because I'm like, I'm not even going to get my, like, I'm not going to put on pants to go somewhere and pay valet like, if you're not really worth it. But I really love also because it's like if you're surrounded by people you know or friends of friends of friends, you kind of know that they're good people. And I think that's a huge thing. Like we want, you know, in the I think it was the beginning of Facebook, it was like friends of friends, like you were getting, or maybe it still works like that in their algorithm, but I like that. I think it's sort of like, cool. Well, you know, this person, like maybe you're not an axe murderer. Great.
I think you're exactly right. It's a lot more natural. It's a lot more, you're going in without being nervous because you're just hanging out with friends. So mm-hmm. you're more authentic.
Yeah.
You don't get catfished, right? Yeah,
I know.
That's not to say that there's not bad people that are at those events. You still have to do your due diligence and do your homework, but it's just a much more authentic kind of old school way of meeting people. And, you know, a lot of times men and women, especially in my age category, put so much pressure on themselves to find their next plus one. Yeah. And my biggest advice is take that pressure off. You know, you got to swim upstream against all the cultural stigma that if you're single and you're 45, then you're weird. You just have to swim upstream, but you got to be really social and you got to be intentional with your friends. You've got to be the one organizing. You can't assume that everybody else is going to. Mm-hmm. And if you want to meet organically someone, ultimately, you got to really drive the process. And that's something that I did. When our friend group met, I made sure every Thursday we're going to have a cookout. We're going to invite people and, you know, look where it turned out.
I love that. Okay. So that is brilliant advice. And I want people to take this advice and actually start their cookouts. We're getting vaxxed. We're like, everything is happening. You can see people, you can wear a mask, whatever. Just go out, go see people. What other really important advice do you have for men starting to date or, you know, okay, let's just put a scenario out there. What if you are now dating someone and you're kind of newly out of a divorce and you're kind of feeling like, ooh, I don't think I want to be with this person, but you're like so afraid to break their heart because you know how it feels and you're just like, ah, what's kind of, because I feel like this is a scenario that's happening a lot. What would you suggest that person do to break things off?
Well, I think that's a great question. I think what most people do is they ghost someone, you know, or they do what I've heard. I heard this early in my dating. It's the slow fade. The communication frequency is like this, and then someone yeah. starts to kind of fade off.
Yeah.
And I've just, you know, it's funny. I've got two friends that are female, and they go on a date, and it didn't go well, and they just feel so bad of providing that guy with feedback. And so they don't communicate. And I'm like, mm-hmm. I was like, you're doing it all wrong because not only are you ghosting, but you're also you're developing a reputation that's not going to be good, especially locally. Mm-hmm. You got to cut it off, nip it at the bud. And so I think honesty and being direct is always the best policy.
I agree.
And I got to a point where if I went on a date and I didn't feel it, the next morning I would send the message and I'd say, I really enjoyed the date. It was nice to get to know you. I didn't feel like there's a romantic connection here, but you know, would love to be your friend only if I was willing to be their friend. So don't say that if you're not, otherwise you just say best of luck. And my girlfriends always were like, I can't believe you just sent that. But every time I'd get back, oh my gosh, I appreciate your honesty. I wish you the best. You're always going to get, in most cases, a positive response. Even if you've dated for four or five times and you're just not feeling it, it's still okay to have to convey that message, but you got to convey it.
I so agree with you. I've always done that and I've never had someone be upset. I mean, sure, maybe they're disappointed, but they are like, thank you for just being honest. And I wish more people would do that because, you know, I've been on the other end of it. We're like, wait, hello? Like what? I thought we were going somewhere. Like what happened? And then you have to like make up maybe what happened. But at the end of the day, like, you know, it wasn't working.
And you don't have to explain yourself. So if you get into a situation where someone's trying to really understand why, or they get defensive or upset about it, just say, I didn't feel it. You know, I tried, we went out for several times and didn't feel it. Yeah. We wish you the best and then be done. But at least you communicated it and there's closure. It's not having the closure that kills people.
Right.
Because they get hurt about it. You know, they go through anger and sadness and disappointment. And then they're looking at their phone waiting for to communicate. And then some end up going crazy. Mm-hmm. And so I just think being open and direct is always the best policy. It's always paid off for me. And it sounds like for you as well.
Absolutely. I know a lot of women, you know, ghosting is such a huge thing and we're already talking about it, but you know, as a man, like why do men ghost? Is it just the fear of having to be honest? Like, hey, I'm not into you. Or, you know, a lot of women are like, oh, he's scared or he just got out of a divorce. Like, what is that? What, I know there's different variations of it, but.
I think it's one of two things. I think 75% of the time, it's the fear of disappointing or hurting someone. And I think the other 25% is that the man is overwhelmed because he's talking to about 9 other women. And he's, I mean, this is the reality of it. I mean, you can look at the dating app stats, and I think that they said at any given time, a man is talking to 7 women at the same time, at the same level. So don't assume, oh my gosh, this banter is like none other. This guy's flirting. He's all over me. He's doing it with 6 other women.
Right.
So
I mean, yeah.
A lot of times that's so overwhelming. You know, you get a text from someone, how's your day that you dated? And then you're over here because that's a lot hotter right now. And then by the time you circle back, it's been 3-4 days and you're like, I don't want to respond. Then I'm going to have to explain myself. Then you ghost.
Yeah.
And that's really what's happening.
That's so true.
I've been guilty of it.
I'm guilty.
You know what I would do? Here's what I would say though. Just like I think it's never too late to send a thank you note, you could send a thank you note to someone that gave you a wedding gift 20 years ago. Yeah, it's late, but at least you did it. I think it's never too late to circle back to people you ghost and apologize and say,
oh, I love that.
You know what? I stopped communicating with you. You don't have to go into why, even though they'll want it. And it was wrong. And I just wanted to say, I'm sorry. That's it. I don't think that it's too late to go back to people and apologize for something that you can own that you did wrong.
Just like AA.
Right. Exactly.
I agree so much. I wish more people would do this. And I think that saying thank you or explaining, even if it's later, it's so nice. People really want to know. I remember, you know, I was off and on with someone for years and I was in my 20s. So your 20s are a whole other situation. But finally, I was like, what is going on with us? And he wrote me a huge letter. I wrote him a huge letter. And we really did have a closure. And like, I've used what he told me as knowledge moving forward. And so that's why it is so important to say the truth to somebody and to let them take it. Hopefully they take it the right way. Hopefully they use it properly to, you know, choose wisely. But even if they don't, it's like, you know, it's still there unless
and you know,
they delete
the thing
it.
Is that whether you live in LA or Chicago or New York, like a big city, is, you know, people talk. And so you will build a reputation and you want to maintain a good reputation, especially if you're dating casually or if you're dating on the dating apps. And so, I mean, I would so much, you know, how, I think it's an impact if some, you know, the women sit around, they're like, look at this guy, I'm going on a date with him. And the person next to her says, well, I was talking to him and he was a gentleman. Or, yeah, we went on a date once and he messaged me the next day and said it didn't work. Mm-hmm. Man, you're building yourself as you're developing a good reputation of being a good dater.
Yeah.
And if you don't, you're going to develop that reputation of being a fuckboy or a bad, you know, a guy that is disrespectful or whatever. And so I think it's important.
Right. So. And also, you know, if you're being honest with someone and they choose to take it defensively or be defensive about it, that's on them. You know, I think it's important to remember as the person who's brave enough to say, hey, you're lovely, but this didn't work.
Right. That's right.
Yeah. Is there anything you'd like to tell people that is important that I have not covered yet?
No, I will say this. I hear so many times how people just have a negative perception or feel so negative about dating. And I think that really will play into your dating life. I think that you'll attract that. And so, you know, I think a lot of it is just really having a positive attitude and realizing that, you know, if you're really intentionally looking for someone, it's a numbers game. It's going to take a lot of time and effort. And, you know, take the pressure off, focus on cultivating a friendship first with every person that you meet and have fun. And I think too many people are just, you know, too focused on trying to find the end game when it is a journey and it takes a long time.
Absolutely. Tell people how they can find you.
Well, my Instagram, I do a lot of kind of blogging, kind of like, you know, what's going on in my life or what I'm thinking about. And so the best way to find me is on Instagram, which is at Daniel, D-A-N-I-E-L dot Harold, H-E-R-R-O-L-D. And so I blog there. And I also run this divorce community, which is called Divorced Over 40 on Instagram. So it's Divorced Over 40. And we do push a lot of content and have a lot of those cookout type social events all the time. So you can find me in both places.
I love it. Do you have to be divorced to go to the cookout?
The social events, we are open to people that are, you know, we've had 35 year olds there. We've had 65 year olds there. So we're a lot more inclusive when it comes to the Facebook groups where there's a lot of raw, authentic vulnerability. That's only for the divorced and widowed communities. So if someone's never been married, then we typically don't allow them in those groups because we feel like we want it to be a safe space for that community.
That's great to know for people who are newly divorced or widowed. Thank you so much, Daniel. This has been really lovely chatting with you.
You bet. Thanks for having me on. It's good to get to know you.
I'm so glad you found love.
I know. It's great, isn't it? Yeah. I'm starting to roll that out now to like my audience. So like I posted a picture of her on Instagram. It was a number of photos and I lost like 25, 30 people. I'm like, okay. Well,
they're damn.
It's like, I guess those aren't the people that are my people, which is fine. I mean, that's not what I'm looking for, but yeah, it's great. It's crazy. And, you know, I keep trying to figure out what's wrong with this woman. I can't figure anything out. She's perfect for me. So
I really think that, you know, this is what I'm telling myself because I'm always in like long-term relationships and I'm finally dating with purpose right now. I'm really actively, because I never date. I just never date. And now I'm like, okay, I'm really going to do this. This is a numbers game. Everything we talked about. I'm like, all right. But I keep thinking like, yes, there's a lot of weirdos out there, but like, I'm out there, so there must be someone else like me out there. And it sounds like you found someone like you out there.
And there is on the dating apps too. It just takes a long time. And I tell people that, you know, women, I think there's stats that say that like women swipe right 7% of the time, you know, so 7 out of 100 guys. And then of the 7, you know, maybe you're going to get 1 out of 100 there that you really feel like a strong connection. And so, I mean, it takes a lot of effort to find people, but there are good people on the dating apps. But you got it sounds like you do, you have to do a lot of due diligence up front so that you're not wasting your time and having the phone calls and the FaceTime, you know, videos and getting to know them. I always try to get like their Instagram so I can look at what's important to them.
Yeah, exactly.
You really learn a lot about the pictures that they post and what's important to them, what's not. And so I try to do I used to do a lot of recon to try to figure out, okay, who is this person? But, you know, it saves you a lot of time of wasting your time if you do that stuff.
Yeah. Like I actually just had to send a text to someone I was talking to you for the last 2 weeks, but it did not feel like 2 weeks. It felt like 2 months. Like he was this. Oh my God. I was like, Jesus Christ. Like this man is texting me like, good morning, good night. Like calling me every day, 2 hour conversations. Yeah. I'm like, I'm a little smothered here. And like, he's a good dude, I think. But because I haven't actually talked to like a guy about this. Like I have a gazillion girlfriends and we're all very close. But I was like, it's weird. He's wonderful. He's smart. There's all this good stuff happening. And I do not like bad boys, but I'm like, I don't know what it is, but my body is like, and I was like, you know, I think this is just my subconscious picking up triggers that maybe my brain can't figure out right now, but my body knows. And so instead of doubting myself, I'm going to be like, yeah.
Trust your gut.
Seriously. I was like, I can't pinpoint it.
Imagine if you were dating him exclusively, he'd be like, where are you? Yeah. Who are you talking to?
Yes.
He would smother the hell out of you.
Oh my God. I was like, oh, I need to breathe. And like, I like being committed, but I'm like, this is a lot. It's a lot. So,
I know, right?
Yeah, it's crazy. So anyway.
Yeah, it's funny.
Oh, what were we going to say?
Well, no, I was just saying, keep your chin up and keep trying. And
thanks.
And, you know, I think the process is fun if you make it fun. If you put too much pressure on yourself, then it's never going to be fun.
Yeah. I think I'm trying to make it fun this time where I'm just thinking like, well, I interview people for a living. So it's like, what's the difference? You know? Yeah.
I think if you have an insatiable curiosity and you go in saying, I'm going to see if this guy would be a good friend, and I'm going to ask him a lot of questions, because that's what friends do. They're curious about each other's lives. The night's probably going to be fun, and then you're going to leave it at the end of the day saying, I really like this guy. Whether it's, as I always tell people, if you go in with a friendship intention, the worst thing that can happen is the romantic side isn't there, but now you have a new friend.
Yeah.
Whereas if you go in just trying to figure out if he's going to be your one or not, if it's not there, you're never going to talk to him again.
Right.
So why not default to, at least I've got a friend, because he's a cool guy, I just went into him romantically.
Mm-hmm.
Isn't that a better approach? And so that's how I think we did it. And man, all these, I mean, 10 of the women that I dated once that became friends are now involved in my divorce community. So, you know, it's, and they're friends. And we text and we catch up, and it's a lot of fun.